today we are hosting in collaboration with
the Smithsonian Transcription Center. So I'm Carlene. I'm the coordinator for the Transcription Center. And currently we have over 11,600 digital volunteers who help us every day to transcribe and make more accessible Smithsonian digitized collections from around the institution. And so one of the reasons that we're doing this today is to kind of launch more enrichment series between both on-site and digital volunteers so that we all know about each other, we can
was the best available ham for quite some time, and it stimulated almost all of the research that was done since then about robotic grasping hams. Up until that time, robot hams were around since the 60s, but they were basically just jaws of grasping on the end of an industrial robot. Okay, you might not think about a self-driving car as a robot, but it is. There's no driver in this car. It won a race. It won a race in 2005 across 132 miles of the desert, sponsored by DARPA, the Defense Advanced Research Projects Agency. We were at the time in the middle of two wars in the Middle East, and DARPA was interested in having self-driving vehicles that could conquer desert terrain to serve perhaps as convoys, truckloads of materials, supplies, and so in the interest of furthering this kind of development, DARPA staged a number, three in fact, of self-driving car races to see what was out in the rest of the United States. There were lots of student projects that turned up, and this was the winner. We collected Stanley from the group that built it. It was a combination of Stanford University and VW, the car, obviously it's VW, the Curator. And you can see this robot vehicle on display today in the Aerospace Museum. It's in the Time and Navigation exhibit on the second floor east. Okay, I'm cheating a little bit here. There are actually three robots in that picture. R2-D2 and C-3PO, of course, are the most famous robots in our collection. These are actually two of many R2-D2s and C-3PO's. Depending upon the scene in the Star Wars movie, there was either a figure or a costume. And these are both costumes. Inside that R2-D2, a very small man named Kenny Baker, there was a seat inside there for him to sit and manipulate parts of R2-D2. The name of the actor who was inside C-3PO, there must be a Star Wars fan here. It just went out of my head. But both of these are costumes, and they represent the fantasy side of the whole robotics scene. We had robots in our imagination long before we had real robots. And the robot arm, yellow robot arm in the back, is an example of how robots actually came into being. The very first robots were industrial, purpose-built machines. So that's my quick summary of my five favorites. If I gave this talk next week, I probably would have five other favorites. And so I'm going to stop there and ask if you have a question.
Are these in the collections on display?
These are not on display now, but they will be on display in our new entertainment exhibition, which is opening in a few years. It's in development right now, so they'll come out. They come out every once in a while. Most recently for May the 4th, as in the Star Wars Day, the secretary actually came to American History and visited with R2-D2 and C-3PO in one of our behind-the-scenes spaces. So, depending on what's going on, they make it here.
Isn't this just costumes? Are there actual robots?
that's really good.
Yes. Are you in pursuit of any items currently to add to your collection?
Yes. Some of them I can't talk about. but from Ken Salisbury, I think it's safe to say, the man who did the robot armor, he has spent a career developing various kinds of grasping devices. And he's also the kind that